Welcome everybody to our monthly meeting. It's March and spring is right around the corner, and I think like the rest of you, we're all kind of excited to get thinking about fly fishing. And I already remember to start the recording. Tonight's presenter is a dear friend of our club, former member, and we're really looking forward to what Chris Walker has to present. We'll formally introduce him in a few moments. But first, let me welcome you and remind you that that we've got a virtual spring. We are beginning to think about getting outdoors, and when we can get outdoors, we feel more comfortable that we can do that safely. So we're beginning to plan some really cool fishing trips and an outdoor meeting. Hopefully COVID safety will be with us. But until then, we're gonna be doing things virtually. Tonight, as all our program meetings are coming to you either through Zoom or Facebook Live. If you're on the Zoom side of it, we invite you to keep your mic on mute. And if you're having trouble keeping your mic on mute, I will help you with that. So if you're not putting your mic on mute, you may notice that the host will. So if you want to talk, please do. We want your participation. Just take your mic off of mute and kind of wait for the right time. I'm sure Chris loves the questions. On Zoom, I just want to remind you that the view that you see is selectable. So you can decide however you want to watch this. We recommend that you set it up as a side-by-side or on the speaker view. What I'll be doing on the Facebook stream will duplicate what my screen is, and it's actually I'll go between speaker view and side-by-side view. If you're joining us through the Facebook Live, we really want to encourage you to participate. We want to invite you to comment and ask questions. Feel free to share with all the club members and fly fishing friends through the Facebook comments. Myself, Bob Carlson, we're monitoring both Facebook and Zoom, and we will pass along those questions at the right time through the Zoom call. All right. So what we're going to be doing tonight is Chris is going to start out, instead of doing our normal MO of the fly tying demo, he's going to share some skills on adjusting your leader. And how to engineer your leader to the fishing condition. So I think this is a really cool thing. And somebody's not listening. Please keep your mics on mute. Thank you. And so we're gonna get started with that as instead of the fly tying. About 7 o'clock, I'm gonna share a few club announcements, and that will allow Chris and no end time, we'll just go with the flow with his presentation. So you can, Chris, you can pace yourself to the questions and we don't have to worry about getting out of facility, but you might. Chris is actually joining us from the Rio headquarters tonight. So let's, this is that, that's, so let me stop the share. And let me welcome Chris Walker. I have a formal introduction for Chris here before he starts his formal presentation. And I'll leave that for when we have more folks gathered. So Chris, I'm gonna turn it over to you.
Okay, thanks, Kirk. thanks for having me back too. I know I presented for the club about a year ago. I guess a little bit over a year ago. So get me off. That's almost the second time around. So I will go ahead and share my screen with you guys. Hopefully that's coming up.
Yeah.
Perfect. So like Kirk said, sort of the main event is going to be at 7. That's all about fly line design and what I do at Rio as it pertains to fly lines. This is sort of just the warm up, and it's going to be all about leaders. So of course, Rio manufactures leaders as well. There's a lot of design and thought that goes into those. So this part of the presentation is all just going to be focused on leaders, why we have so many, what they're meant to do for you, and how they're going to help you catch more fish, and then hopefully how you can actually tune them in the field to catch even more fish. That's the idea anyway. So with that, we will jump in. So the first question you sometimes get on leaders is, why do you even bother with a tapered leader, right? It's everybody knows that the leader is the clear piece that goes between your thick, opaque fly line and your fly. The most obvious thing is the fish can't see it as well as they can a fly line. But the reality is there's a lot more that goes into a leader than just being clear. It's actually the continuation of the front taper of a fly line. So when you think about taper, lots of people jump right to fly lines. And of course, we spend a lot of time and effort tuning those tapers as well. But what I would argue is that your fly line is only as good as the taper that's in your leader. Like if you've got the right fly line for the scenario, but the wrong leader, you're going to have just as hard a time doing anything useful on the water. So it's pretty important to understand how these tapers work. And really the kind of the mark of a leader working versus not working is something called turnover. And that's a colloquial term that's familiar to a lot of anglers, but other people have not heard it before. So just to all start at the basics here, the way I think about turnover is a perfect cast, you've made your loop, the loop is kind of progressing down the length of your fly line, then it gets to the leader. If everything goes to plan, the leader will basically continue to propagate that loop and your fly will end up right at the end of your leader, sort of gently, and then flutter down to the water. There's times you make different casts, you want to put slack into the leader, you want to put a curve in the leader, but for just a generic straight up the gut cast, you want that fly to sort of slowly reach the end of the leader and then flutter down to the water. Problems with turnover can happen when you have too much power. In that situation, basically your fly has too much energy, it flies all the way to the end of the leader, it just yanks it tight and you actually get kind of like a recoil effect. The line will actually spring back on itself and your leader might land in the pile. The opposite problem would be not enough power on turnover. And that happens when the loop never reaches the end of the leader. Your leader is still doubled over when your cast runs out of energy. And again, your leader falls in a pile on the river or the lake. Not an ideal situation. So the taper of the leader is actually the thing that determines how well it's going to turn over. And there's three sections that are important to understand. And you can see them in the diagram there, but I've got a leader here I can just show you as well. So if you're not familiar with this, I encourage you to grab a tapered leader and you can actually feel this and kind of see what goes into the taper of a leader. So there's a butt section, which is level, meaning the diameter doesn't change. And you can actually feel when that diameter starts to change. That's the thick end of the leader. I can feel it's about right here where that starts to taper down. So you can see it's maybe 3.5-4 feet long of butt. Then you have a tapered section where the leader actually changes diameter very rapidly. And you can feel where that diameter change stops as well. So that's about right here. That's only maybe a 2.5-foot taper. Then last but not least, you have the thinnest section, which is level again, meaning no change in diameter. And that's the tippet. So every leader has those three basic components. But of course, there's a million leaders out there. So how do you end up with so many different types of leaders, and why do we have so many types of leaders? So if you've ever been in a fly shop and looked at the wall of leaders, you'll know that there's like hundreds of choices, literally. And it can be baffling if you don't really know what you're looking for and you don't know why a leader will help you do one thing versus another. It might not make any sense to you why there's so many out there. But the first place to start is really the two numbers that manufacturers specify on every leader. The first being length. So the one I just showed you is a 9-foot leader. That's pretty self-explanatory. It's 9 feet long. And it's also specified by the diameter at the tibid, which in this case is 5X. So there's this whole system of X's, which can be just totally baffling to some people. Every X size corresponds specifically to a diameter. And the way that rule works is you get the diameter by doing 11 thousandths of an inch minus the number of X's. So for example, if I have a 3X tippet, that's 11 thousandths minus 3. My tippet should be 8 thousandths of an inch. 5X should be 11 thousandths minus 5. That should be 6 thousandths of an inch. Just a piece of trivia there. It's not that relevant to most people. Really, the number everybody looks at is strength. They want to know, like, how hard can I pull on that fish before something breaks? So we specify that, too. We've got both numbers on typically every package of leaders. And of course, they come in a million different lengths and a million different sizes. We've got everything from 6-foot leaders up to 15-foot leaders, everything from 7X, which is like 2 pounds, up to, you know, 60, 80 pounds for a shock tippet on like big game leaders. So that's part of the reason you have all this variation. The other reason there's so many out here is that they vary in both material and taper. And really, taper is the part I want to focus on, but that's how we end up with so many families of leaders. And Rio alone sells leaders out of about 23 different families. And within each family, there's dozens of sizes in some cases. So the bad news is there's a million to choose from. The good news, depending on how you look at it, is that you don't need to choose the right one every time to make them work correctly for your given application. You can actually tune them while you're on the water. To make the taper more advantageous for your fishing situation. So with that said, you'll hear a bunch of different thoughts and ideas on how to tune leaders. Everybody you ask has got their own kind of pet formula, like add 6 inches of this, cut 18 inches off of that, different knots, different materials, different colors of materials. But really, I would argue that there's only one universal rule that you need to remember to at least adjust your leader directionally in the right way. And that is, the more mass you have close to the fly, the more powerfully your leader is going to turn over. And mass in this case can mean a couple of things. It can mean the mass of the fly line. It's typically more massive than the leader. So just a shorter leader puts that fly closer to the end of the fly line. It could also mean the mass of the butt of the leader. So if your tippet section is shorter, your leader will turn over more powerfully because it puts that fly closer to the heavy butt section. So I've actually got kind of like the 6 examples I like to think about here. There's really like 3 things all vary typically in a leader to make it work right. First is length. As I mentioned, if you have a shorter leader that puts your fly close to the massive fly line, that'll turn over more powerfully. The converse, of course, is a longer leader, turns over more delicately. You can also have a relatively longer butt section. So these two leaders are now the same length. They might both be 9-foot leaders, but this one is mostly butt and very little tippet. Well, this one is mostly tippet and very little butt. So again, your fly is closer to more mass. In this leader, it's going to turn over more powerfully. In this one, your fly is further from the mass because you have this long tippet section. It's going to turn over more delicately. The last one that bears mentioning is just diameter itself. So you can make the entire leader more massive by just increasing the diameter throughout. And that's something you'll see as you get into, you know, saltwater rod sizes, like a 5-weight, 9-foot leader, sorry, a 9-foot 5X leader, typical of trout fishing, is going to be smaller in diameter in every dimension than a 9-foot, 10-pound bonefish leader, for example. The whole thing will be thicker. And that does two things. It matches the heavier fly line better, and it also maintains more mass through the leader, so the leader itself will turn over more powerfully. So that's the only rule that I like to talk about here. So now I'll actually just give you a quick demo to show that you can tell how well your leader is going to turn over without even taking it out on the river. So I'll use this one as an example here. Again, this is the 9'5" leader. And I'll actually show you what I've got tied on here. This is a little piece of fuzz, a little yarn fly that's pretty typical of what you throw on a 9'5" leader. It might be a small dry fly, small nymph, something like that. And if I zoom out, I think you'll be able to see this a little better. As you can see, I'm in a room that's just big enough to do a forward cast with a 9-foot leader. So that's just what I'll do. And this is the demo that our brand manager, Simon Gosworth, showed me just a couple of years ago. I'd never seen anybody do this until he mentioned it to me. But you can actually just cast the leader with your hand. So you can see if I do a forward cast, it turns that fly over really nicely. It's got just enough power to turn it over. Not so much that it's just pinging around out there, and not so little that I can't make it go all the way out there. So that would be an example of a pretty well-balanced leader. I'll give you another example. This goes back to the why bother with a tapered leader, right? This is just 9 feet of 3X tippet. So no taper at all, just a level piece of tippet. And you can see I can like really knock myself out. I can put my back into it and like, you know, throw my arm out of the socket, try to cast this thing, and it's never going to turn that piece of fuzz over. And that's because there's so little mass in this leader, it just can't carry the fly. Another example would be that same 9'5" leader. I've just got another one here. And this one is rigged up with a much bigger fly. This is a fly that I would, or it's representative of the size fly I would never try to use with a 9'5" leader. This might be more like a bass bug or a streamer or something like that. So that same leader that worked well with the small fly, if I do the same demo, now all of a sudden I can't get that fly to go anywhere. So now you're probably starting to see why it's important to change your leader or to be able to tune your leader. So the leader that worked great for my little dry fly is no longer gonna work when I put a fly this size on the end of it.
So Chris, is that what you're referring to as the turnover power of the leader?
That's exactly right. So the one that wouldn't carry the big fly, it doesn't have enough turnover power to actually deliver that fly and make your loop propagate all the way to the end of the leader. So this one, that's about the same size fly. I'll just show you here, kind of the same big fluffy sized piece of fuzz there. But now I've got it on a very different leader. I've got it on a 6-foot, 16-pound leader. This is a leader we sell, it's called a big nasty leader. And as the name suggests, it's for throwing big nasty flies. So again, I do the same demo, and now all of a sudden I can turn that fly over a piece of cake. Okay. So that's the demo. I think it's kind of an interesting one, mostly because I didn't know you could actually do that until a couple of years ago. I think I'm gonna go ahead and share my slides again. How's that looking on your end, Kirk? Are you seeing anything?
Not yet, buddy.
Let's see what happened here. Okay, here we go. I think I got it back. There we go. That should be the ticket.
Yep, we got her.
Okay, anyway, that's the universal law of leaders. Shorter, thicker is more powerful, longer and finer, less powerful. So in practice, you know, that's exactly how we think about it when we're designing these things. So I've got kind of like four quadrants of leader design here. There's the short and powerful, which means it's a short leader. It's got heavy.
If that's what you do, turn around. I got a use for you. Besides, I'm bored.
Hang on.
It's so easy.
Oh, that was exciting.
Yeah, it never happened before.
Must be boring somebody to death.
Must be.
Okay, anyway, I got sort of four quadrants of leader design up here. They're short and powerful, which is the one I was just casting that big piece of fuzz on. It's a short leader, and it's got a pretty stout tippet. So that works great. That's sort of the best for turning over a really big fly with maximum power. The next would be long and delicate. So this is kind of typical of what you'd use with dry flies. In fact, this is my very favorite dry fly leader of all time. 12-foot 4X supple flex trout is what we call it. So that's delicate for two reasons. It's delicate because it's relatively long, and it's also got a relatively light tippet. And this is a really good one for big rivers. You can kind of tune it as you see fit, lighter tippet if you feel like it, but good all around dry fly leader. You've also got the short and delicate leader, which is kind of an overlooked category. So we make ones, you know, a good example would be a 7.5-foot 5X. And this is a leader I might take with me if I was going to fish a really small stream for small fish. You don't need a long leader. And in fact, it's probably harder to fish a long leader just because your casts are short and you need to get some fly line out the tip of the rod to make it work. And then last but not least would be a long and powerful. So this would be a leader with a thick butt, a relatively thick taper, and a relatively thick tippet, but it's longer. So a bonefish leader is a great example of this one, where you need it to be long enough to keep your fly far enough from the line not to spook the fish, but you also want it to turn over very powerfully if you're fishing in wind or if you're throwing a little bit bigger fly. So one option, you know, if you're going to fish a range of techniques, one option is to just totally stock up on leaders, like buy one of every one. I don't recommend doing that. I work for the company and I don't recommend you buy one of every leader SKU. That'd be crazy. So having a selection is a smart idea to match a bunch of different scenarios. But if you're like me and you lack the foresight to plan ahead and put the right things in your bag before you go fishing, and you find yourself kind of out of hand and you don't have the right leader, then you can start tuning them. And this is really the strategy I employ, is I have a few generic leaders with me, and I go to the river with maybe just one or two types of leaders and then a bunch of material for adding tippet or adding butt sections. And the reason is you'll see all kinds of different stuff on the river. So these pictures were all taken within about a month of each other in Idaho last year. The top right are salmon flies, so just a big fluffy stone fly, and the flies you throw are much like the big foam flies I was just throwing in here. So you need a pretty powerful leader to turn those over, but you also need it to be long because those fish tend to be shy of the line. Bottom right is a little betis mayfly. So you use really small, light, dry flies to imitate those, and you need a long, fine leader. And then in the bottom left here, if you had any aspirations to catch a true trophy sucker on a double articulated 6-inch streamer, my buddy AJ here, he's the man. but really, I included this picture just because it's obvious what the fish ate. I mean, we were throwing these giant streamers, and it is probably, I bet more 2-foot brown trout have been caught on streamers like that than suckers like that. So that might be the true trophy. But for that kind of fly, you need a totally different leader, and you're not going to be able to get it done with just a generic dry fly leader. So with that said, I've got some guidelines for tuning your leader here. These are sort of the rules I live by. The first one is a little bit tongue in cheek, but you know, like I said at the beginning, everybody's got their own formula that works for them. And if you talk to people who are meticulous about it, they'll tell you to start with exactly this leader. You need exactly a 10-foot 4X leader, and then you need to chop exactly 25 inches off of it and add 12 inches of this and 16 inches of that. I never measure the lengths. Maybe I'm selling myself short for doing it that way, but I basically always do this by trial and error. And I feel like I've done enough of it to just have kind of an idea, a ballpark idea of where I need to end up. But really the way this works is, even if I guess wrong and I go out and try to cast, let's say I'm trying to tune my leader to be more delicate. If I take that out on the water and it's not delicate enough, I know what to do. I just have to add a little bit more tippet. Or if I'm trying to tune it for more power and it's not powerful enough, I know exactly what I have to do. I just have to cut a little bit more tippet off. anyway, that's really the crux of that bullet point. Then with tippet diameters too. So when you're joining two pieces of tippet, the rule of thumb I use is if they're within 2X sizes, so 3X to 5X, 4X to 6X, I can usually get away with a strong blood knot. Any more than that, if I'm trying to join, you know, 2X to 5X or 2X to 6X, you're not going to be successful with a standard blood knot. And then you can eyeball this too. So if I've chopped the tippet off my leader and I just end up somewhere up the taper and I don't know where to start, I can just put that end of the leader next to my tippet. You know, if it's bigger than 2X, I'll pull out my 1X. If it's bigger than 1X, I'll pull out my 0X. I don't carry a micrometer on the river, and I don't recommend anybody else does either. I spend enough time measuring stuff in the office. So anyway, I eyeball the tippet diameters to make sure I'm abiding by that rule. And then the last rule is butt diameters. So, you know, I think as manufacturers, we specify the tippet diameter and we specify the total length. I would kind of like to see us start specifying the butt diameters of leaders as well, because that's, I think, an important part of this equation. But the rule of thumb I use is for 4 to 6 weight lines, 024, 24 thousandths of an inch is a pretty typical and useful butt diameter. And then it just steps up from there as you go up in line weights, all the way up to a 10 to 12 weight line. 30 thousandths might be the right butt diameter for that type of leader. And we actually sell, Rio sells a product called butt material. Let me see if I can zoom. Yeah, there we go. So that's, we actually write this right on the packaging too, is 024. That's appropriate for 4, 5, and 6 weight lines. So practically what I do on the river is I carry a few generic leaders. If I had to choose just one, it would be a 9-foot 3X leader. And then if I want to adjust my setup, I just start cutting and tying from there. So I'll just give you a really quick demo. here I've got a 9-foot 5X leader, and I'll show you how to get these apart without horribly, horribly tangling them. And I think this is valuable. I wouldn't have included this had I not been out fishing with a guy who's been fly fishing for 30 years. He's a friend of mine from a Trout Unlimited chapter in North Carolina. Super skilled angler, fished all over the world. And we were streamside in Idaho, and I was putting together a leader. And he asked me just point blank, he's like, how do you get those things apart without tangling them? And over the course of 30 years, I bet this guy has tangled like 500 leaders horribly on the side of the river. So I'll show you how to not do that. You don't have to wait 30 years for this vital information. These things are coiled from the tippet end first. So we start with the thin end and we coil from there up to the thick end. So to get it apart, I'll start with the thick end and I'll just start backing it out of the coil until it feels like it's kind of coming loose on me. This one's wrapped up pretty good. So now I got the butt end loose, and I'll just start pulling it off my fingers like that. So this way I'm pulling the strand that's on the outside. Everything that's on the inside should stay in pretty good order. And there you can see I managed to do it without tangling it. So if you learned nothing else from the presentation today, hopefully that helps you. Then the next thing I'll do, I see way too many people take a leader that looks like this and just loop it onto their fly line. And that is just the recipe for frustration. What I'll do first is actually straighten it. I mean, this thing is a slinky. Just like if you had been on a long car ride and you're kind of kinked up and you need to stretch, I like to stretch my leaders when I take them out of the bag. So there you go. A quick little stretch like that, and it's going to lay much straighter. I'll do that all the way down to the tippet, and the thing should behave itself a little bit better. Okay, now this is a 9'5" leader, and that's the leader I started the demo with. It throws a small fly great. So if I get to the river and there's little mayflies hatching or caddis or what have you, and I'm going to tie on a dry fly, perfect, I'm done. I just loop this onto the end of my fly line, tie the fly on, and get going from there. But if I wanted to throw a really big streamer, like a giant sucker type streamer, I'll just feel my way up this tippet until I get into the tapered section. And again, I'm eyeballing it here. Like a typical streamer leader is like 0X, 1X, 2X, something like that. If I want to get really fancy, I might put it next to my tippet to figure out just how big 2X really is. But I don't really care to do that. I'll just chop it. So now that that's chopped off, I can actually just tie it to my fly. And just for demonstration purposes, I've got another piece of big fuzz here. So I'll tie this to the end of the leader and show you that it's going to work just great for a streamer now. So there's that tied on. Zoom out so you can see what's going on here. Now that same 9'5" leader that wouldn't throw this fly before, now that I've shortened it way up, is going to throw it just fine. So you can see that's turned the fly over, no trouble. So that's how I would go about making an appropriate streamer leader out of a 9'5" leader. Now, just to stick with the example in the slide, if I wanted to tune this up to throw a big dry fly at the bank, for instance, a big fluffy salmon fly pattern or something like that, I'll take some of my butt material, which again is about 24 thousandths inches diameter. And I can tie a blood knot right to the butt of this material. So there you go, there's my blood knot. Give that leader butt some straightening also, just because I think that's important. Now I've got a much longer leader that should still turn over this fly. That one's a little bit light still. I'm having to work pretty hard to get that to turn over, so I might cut the tippet back just a little further. But that's just a good example of how I would tune a leader on the river. So I started with a leader that's great for dry fly. Within a couple minutes, you can make a leader that'll work great for streamers. And then a couple minutes after that, you've got a leader that'll work just fine for a big dry fly that you might throw at the bank. And that's pretty much it. So with that, I'll open it up to any questions you guys have.
Yeah, let's stop a moment. Anybody have questions on leaders before we get into the main presentation? By the way, Chris, we've got 22 on Zoom and we got 11 on the Facebook stream.
All right.
I think I've got, I'm not sure. That was the first time we got Zoom bombed. I put some precautions in place. We'll see what happens. Ken, do you have a question?
I do. Hey, Chris, do you also, can you contrast a poly leader versus those for the single hand rod in terms of any suggestions for selection of poly leaders?
Yeah, that's a great question. So if anybody's not familiar with a poly leader, that's a product that actually Airflow originated way back when. Rio sells a very similar product. We call it a Versa leader, but basically what this is instead of just a nylon monofilament that's tapered, a poly leader is a thin nylon monofilament core coated with a tapered fly line coating. So it's kind of just like a mini fly line in itself. They come in various lengths, they come in various weights, and they come in various densities. So we change the density of the coating that goes on those. The idea being you're going to use it to sink your fly a little bit more. They're really popular with two-handed fishermen. So my thoughts on poly leaders, It gets more complicated because basically you can't make a poly leader as light as you can a nylon leader. It's hard to do. You know, you'd have to put so little coating on it, and it's hard to apply that little coating, especially when the coating's dense. If you've got like a type 5 sinking poly leader, basically to get the same grain weight you would out of a true tapered nylon leader, you have to put next to no coating at all on those things. So unfortunately, I don't have a great rule of thumb for you other than trial and error. The other thing that becomes really important in those situations is the power of the fly line. If the fly line has got a pretty powerful front taper and ends in a pretty large diameter, you can get away with a little bit heavier or a little bit longer poly leader just because you have more weight in the fly line to counteract the weight of the leader and get it to turn over really well. Rio's recommendations, that part of the problem with this too is you've got a bunch of manufacturers of fly lines and a bunch of manufacturers of these Versa leaders or poly leaders. And Rio has a set of recommendations for Rio spay lines matching up with Rio Versa leaders. And I would say that those recommendations are pretty solid. And I'm less confident speaking to what Versa leader or poly leader would work best on a non-Rio line, or vice versa, Rio line with a non-Rio Versa leader. So that was kind of a wishy-washy non-answer. Hopefully that helps.
Good job.
We have a question that came through the chat. And do we have to care much about the stiffness of the butt material as far as turning it over or matching it to the fly line?
That's a great question. Personally, I've not found that stiffness is a huge factor. I think it has a lot more to do with weight. So I think as long as you're matching up diameters well, you're getting 90% of the way there. It is true that stiff materials do turn over a little bit more powerfully, but in my experience, the stiffness is a much smaller factor than the weight. And the example I'd give you to illustrate that would be a furled leader. So I don't know if you've seen those. Rio doesn't actually make any furled leaders, but what those are is it's a bunch of filaments. It might be monofilament. I've seen them made out of all kinds of stuff. It could be another fiber. But basically, to get the weight in the butt of the leader, you're weaving together a bunch of smaller filaments. And what that achieves is very low stiffness, but the same overall weight in the butt of your leader. And basically, those cast just fine too. So having an infinitely supple butt is not going to make the weight of your butt, you know, insufficient to turn over your fly.
Well, cool. I think that's our questions. And how about we roll into the next part of the meeting? Because I'm eager to get going on the presentation. All right. So hang on, we're going to switch presentations. So let me just share a few club announcements and maybe what I should do. Hang on a second here is spotlight me. Good. We'll do it that way. I mentioned this at the beginning, but I just want to share that our club is not planning any indoor gatherings, at least through the spring. Because of COVID, in our area, the numbers are dropping, which is awesome. People are beginning to get vaccinated, which is awesome. And it's beginning to feel like spring a little bit now, although it's gotten cold in the recent day. We are planning in-person fishing trips, and we're planning an outdoor meeting in June. But nothing inside for this foreseeable future. Our main communication is through MailChimp and the Facebook page, which many of you are watching on the live stream. Last month, we were brokenhearted to learn that Steve Harris, longtime member of the club, administered, he was the head administrator of the fly fishing school, and he served on the board of directors since 2008. He passed away. And so we announced that at the last meeting. There was a Zoom session in his honor. I participated in the funeral. And we opened up a memorial fund in the club in Steve's memory. And to date, we've had nearly $860 donated. And I want to share that with Joe, his wife, Joe Harris. We have said we're going to allocate that money that comes in to youth education. That was one of Steve's passions. And a fitting way to pass on his memory to the next generation. So incredible outpouring of gifts. So thank you. And I think I'm still in mourning with his loss. I want to share with you that next month, we have Mike Linetsky and Josh Filter. I think Josh is on, I've forgotten the Zoom or the Facebook. But they're going to be talking to us about spring fly fishing in the Finger Lakes. And Josh and Mike have spoken at the club many times before, and they do a partner kind of presentation that really works really well. And so we've never had them do it on a virtual environment, so we'll get to see how that works. So in April, that's Mike and Josh. And in May, we have, for a very long time, partnered with Leon Chandler Trout Unlimited in Ithaca on a keynote speaker. And I'm just really thrilled to share that we have procured Kelly Gallup. So Kelly Gallup is a legend in fly fishing. He actually lives not that far away from where Chris is. So he lives in Montana, very near West Yellowstone, Montana. He is a legend in streamer fishing, and he owns a fly shop and a hotel there. And we're working out the details of his topic and all the things that we're not ready to announce. But we're really jazzed that Kelly Gallup will be our featured speaker in the spring. Really cool. I'll just mention that we're recording this session, and if you want to watch it later, there's something that Chris says that you'd like to go back and think about a little bit more. Those will be posted on our Facebook page and also our YouTube channel. So if you've got a buddy who you'd like to share this presentation with, feel free. I'll post up the links on the Facebook page. And we do that for all our program meetings. I'll share that we had a special fundraising effort. Because we could not hold the academy last year, nor this, we had a funding gap that emerged. And so Bob Walker stepped forward and said, hey, I'll lead a task force that will raise some money. And he said, I just want to do it as a one-time thing. And the target was to get $1,000. And in fact, you were very, very generous, and over $1,500 were raised. There were various auctions and beer glass sales and a raffle. And a lot of people just donated pure cash. And so we thank you. And we've raised $1,500. That's allows us to breathe a little bit. And we'd like to thank Bob and his team. And yes, that's Chris's dad. And there's a lot of people who really gave a lot to make this successful. Names are on your list or on your screen. We did our first beginner virtual fly tying session. Bill Wirtz was the coordinator. This was complete. Learn how to do this virtually. So we did it through Zoom. The club just bought a camcorder and some support equipment, and we circulated that between the instructors. We had 7 students, and we probably had a total of 4-hour driving time between the students. So we saved a lot of people in the driving time in the car. But what was amazing to me is that the students said they could see better than they could when we did classes in person. And we recorded all the sessions, and the students could go back and review those. We posted those on the Facebook page, but they're not for public view, but they're for the students. And they really appreciated that. So it was a tremendous success. Thanks to Bill Wirtz for pulling this all off. It was a lot of fun to be part of that, and a lot of fun to work with the students. That was really cool. And I'll just share too that we have a master's fly tying demonstration series underway. Matt Collins is coordinating that. We have for this master's class, the format is a little different. It's a demonstration format. So we have chosen fly tires in the club who are pretty good and worth listening to. And so John Lively talked about Coyote Creek flies in January. Eric did a really, really neat demonstration on Atlantic salmon fly tying. And Joe and Mike are on deck. These sessions are open to FFI members who are part of our club. And we limit it up to 20, but anybody can go and take a look at the video from the session. And those are posted on our YouTube channel. So if you want to see Eric demonstrate some Atlantic salmon, just check it out on our YouTube channel. And by the way, if you're not a member, this might be one more good reason to join. We have started a rod raffle. We do this every spring. It's really well received, and tickets are starting to move pretty quickly. What you win if you win this raffle is you win your choice. This of any rod that TFO makes that's a single-handed rod. So you pick out the rod that fits best in what you need. And the ticket prices are here. We'll be drawing this during the meeting with Kelly Gallup. And if you'd like to buy tickets, you can either send Vince Leonard a check, and the details are in the newsletter, or you can get on our website, click on that link, and pay through PayPal, and you buy your tickets there. It's really easy, and the tickets are moving good. So, and the club announcements. So I'm really excited to have Chris here tonight. Chris represents our club in a lot of different ways. And Chris is a good friend. Chris first got connected to our club in 2005, as I have been able to reassemble the history. Chris, you may correct me, but at the seminar in 2005, I perused the pictures and I couldn't find a picture of Chris, but this is Bob. And this is my two kids. This is my son, Luke, and this is my daughter, Kayla. And I think this is the first time that Chris got connected with our club. But it wasn't long after that we got connected and I realized we had a great fisherman in Corning. Chris would join the club. We would teach him what little I knew about fly fishing, and then he became one of the fishiest guys. And so he was a carp fisherman, and I love fishing for carp, and this guy can catch carp, which is really, really, really hard. This picture was taken in 2009, by the way. So over the years that Chris and I have become good friends, we fished together in the West, and we fished together here. In various places, and kind of been able, fortunate to be an engineer like Chris is, and I'm really interested in what he's doing at Rio Fly Lines to help engineer technology for fly fishing. Chris is the son of two of our members, Pam and Bob, and it's kind of interesting that I think Bob was into fishing, but not fly fishing. And Chris has gotten his parents into fly fishing, which is usually the different way the learning goes. So Chris has had an interesting career. He went to Cornell as a material scientist and worked for a semiconductor manufacturer in North Carolina for some time before kind of a job opened up. I got an email from Chris and he would send me this position of a fly line designer at Rio. And he said, what do you think of this job? And I didn't really tell him the truth because at the time I was contemplating retiring. And the truth is that what I thought about is, gee, this would be a great retirement job. But I put that aside and I worked with Chris and he landed the job as the fly line designer at Rio. And since he's been promoted to the head of R&D, and I think he is evidence of what an engineer can do for a very empirical business. And I think you'll get to hear more about that tonight. So without further ado, let's turn it over to Chris.
Thanks for the intro, Kirk. I'm glad you dug up some really old pictures of me. Those are great. And thanks for having me back, and just in general for everything the club does. You weren't exaggerating when you said that it's really, that was sort of how I got more involved in fly fishing. I fly fished a little bit before I got involved in the club, but learned a ton from you and others in the club, and that really kind of got me into it in a way that I hadn't been before. So good on you guys, and good for you for keeping this kind of thing going, even in the middle of a pandemic. I know you've been doing a great job of staying active and keeping everyone engaged. So that's really great to see. All right, so presentation two. If you missed the first one, it was about leaders. This one's gonna have nothing at all to do with leaders. So if you're sick of that, great. We're moving on to fly lines. So this one's all about fly line design and selection. So I'll tell you a little bit about how we design the fly lines, and then also hopefully something that'll help you choose a fly line that's more appropriate for the application that that you're interested in, basically. I think a lot of fly lines get bought and used in a variety of applications that are maybe not ideal. So really picking the right specialty tool for a specialty application is a big part of this presentation. First things first, though, a little bit about what I do. So as Kirk mentioned, I manage the product development group at Rio. I'm coming to you live from Rio R&D World headquarters here in sunny Idaho Falls. It sounds more impressive than it is. Right now it's a group of three people, but what we lack in numbers, we make up for in enthusiasm. So it's a really fun place to work. And we wear a lot of different hats. It's a small company. Like the entire Rio manufacturing facility has maybe 65, 70 people working at it to build a brand that's known kind of worldwide, which is sort of a feat in and of itself. So anyway, because it's a small organization, we all do lots of different things. The first one that we get involved with frequently is process improvement. So it's like any other factory in the world. If you've worked at a factory, you know that sometimes they run seamlessly, sometimes they completely crash and burn, and for the vast majority of the time, it's somewhere in the middle. So we spend a lot of time just trying to make sure we're manufacturing products efficiently and we're doing it repeatably. And we work with our manufacturing and operations team really closely to make sure that happens. I wish I could show you more interesting pictures of the inside of the facility than this, but there's some intellectual property and specialized equipment and things like that that keep me from doing so. The next piece is material selection. So we do all our manufacturing of fly lines here in Eastern Idaho in the building just across the parking lot from where I'm sitting right now. So of course we have to buy raw materials, and a lot of the sourcing of those raw materials and a lot of the performance attributes of the fly line come down to what we do in R&D. So on the left here is a picture of a bunch of different cores that we use. The core of the fly line is really, really important to its performance. It determines sort of the stiffness of the end product, its break strength. Critically, you need to use a strong enough core to land the fish you're chasing. And then also the stretch of the fly line, how much the fly line elongates when you set the hook or when you make your cast. So that's a fundamental piece that we work on sourcing and kind of tuning for maximum performance. The other is the fly line coating. So every core we have gets a coating applied to it. And by changing the amount of coating that goes on the core, that's how we tune the weight distribution of the fly line, which is really important to the way it casts. But even more than that, the coating determines how slick the fly line is going to be. The hardness of the coating determines kind of what temperature range it's going to be appropriate for. And of course, we come up with all kinds of wacky formulations for different colors. They come in every shade of the rainbow. And then the last piece is there's a bunch of additives that go into this coating to make it hopefully resistant to ultraviolet light, you know, tough enough to last a long time, supple enough to perform well and not retain a lot of memory. And then either float or sink or somewhere in the middle, depending on what we're trying to make. So there's a lot that goes into the formulation of the coating itself. And that's a big part of what we work on in my group. Next is taper design. And this is really where fly lines have seen the biggest growth just in what's available in recent years. There's so many different tapers you can get. Some of them are specific to species. We've got a bonefish line and a tarpon line and a permit line. We used to actually have a carp specific line. One of my coworkers jokes that we're gonna have the guppy line before too long. And there's a ton of them out there. It's a crazy variety, but designing the actual tapers and tuning these tapers to make the line appropriate for its intended application is sort of the next big piece. And of course, my favorite part is the field testing. So I'm really fortunate to have a job where I get to fish a lot. There are times when I fish on the clock, like my job for the day is go out and test this line and make sure it works the way it's supposed to. It's awesome when that's in June and there's green drakes hatching. It's not so much fun when it's in February and I'm fishing midge pupa under indicators. I've had some testing days this winter where it didn't crack 25, and those are pretty rocky, but somebody's got to do it. I certainly would never complain about having to go fishing for work. The truth is, though, most of the fishing I do is in my spare time. Really, as Kirk alluded to, the reason I got this job is because I love fishing, and I've certainly fished more in the last 4 years that I lived in Idaho than ever before in my life. So it takes me to cool places too, which is great. The top left is local water. I'm netting a fish for our marketing guy, Simon Gosworth, there. And that's on the South Fork of the Snake, which is only about a 45-minute drive from the office. This is significantly longer than 45 minutes from the office. That's in the Bahamas. I wish that was in the backyard. And then this is, this guy's name is Peter Knox. He's one of the Sage rod designers. I got to go on a really cool trip with him to Cape Lookout, North Carolina, where we fished for mostly false albacore. And we just kind of lucked into this school of redfish. We caught two fish out of the school, and that was one of them. And it was like the most spectacular redfish I've ever seen in my life. But I felt like that one had to make it into the presentation just because he looks really happy. And then in the bottom right here, this is me with a couple of coworkers in Yellowstone, which is also just up the road. It's about 2 hours from my front door to the entrance, the west entrance at Yellowstone National Park. So there's really, I mean, there's an infinitude of fishy opportunities in this area. And I feel really lucky to be here and have part of my job be line testing in those fishy areas. One of the last pieces of what I do is we lend a hand with marketing where possible. And one of the places that comes up is staffing the Rio booth at fly fishing shows. So I've been going to these fly fishing shows for a long time, since I got involved with the club in New York, actually. And I remember the first time I went to a fly fishing show, it was in Somerset, New Jersey. And I just kind of walked around with my mouth hanging open for 3 days, like gawking at all the cool stuff and seeing people whose names I recognized and stuff like that. And I thought that was great. And I'm really happy that I still get to go to these shows and just see them from a totally different perspective. I spend the whole day standing in the Rio booth talking to fishermen like you guys. The club, your club's contingency always stops by. It's really nice to see familiar faces and field questions and catch up that way. But one of the questions I get the most frequently at these shows is just like, why do you have so many lines? People who are new to the sport and are not as educated on fly line offerings, they come into the booth and they see dozens of fly lines on the wall, and then they start asking questions. And when they find out that that doesn't represent even a tenth of the fly lines we make, they're overwhelmed. And I totally get that. There's a vast array of lines out there, and it's just wild how many choices you've got. And it makes it almost unapproachable sometimes to figure out what the right line is for you. But what I usually tell those people is there's a reason we've got so many fly lines, and it's because there's a demand for specialized gear. The applications of fly fishing have grown and evolved so much, so fast, that there's just this steadily growing demand for lines for even more specialized applications. So everything from, you know, air temperatures of 10 degrees up to 110 degrees, for example, flies are incredibly wide ranging. You've got tiny midges that you can, you know, hold 10 of them on the tip of your pinky, up to, you know, foot long streamers or 18 inch streamers or 24 inch streamers. If you are following some of these guys in Wisconsin who are fishing for muskie, you could be fishing dry flies classically to trout, or you could be surf casting for rooster fish, which is about as different as applications come. So really there's kind of a niche for every one of these lines, and Rio has taken the task of just filling each of those niches. Every time we hear about a new cool application, we want to check it out and make a product that works for it. So that still leaves the question of how do you choose the right one, though, right? If you have no idea what we design these things for, and it's baffling to look through the entire catalog, how do you choose the right line? And one line that I've read many times in fly fishing articles goes something like the quote here, where you get to the end of this article about some fishery that sounds really cool, and as an afterthought, they talk about the gear you need to make it work. And they say like, oh, you need a fast action rod, you need a reel with a smooth drag system, and a line to match. And that's just like, that one just irks me, like a line to match. It's like an afterthought, like the fly line that's gonna carry your fly and present your offering to the fish is the last thing mentioned. It even comes after drag system. I mean, nobody needs a smooth drag system for trout fishing. They're nice. I like fishing nice drags, but anyway, that's, I'm obviously coming at it from a biased angle as a line designer, but the line to match tagline always bothered me. So the strategy I would advocate for, and hopefully I'll convince you I'm right by the end of the presentation, is basically consider what you're doing on the water before you pick your line. Consider what flies you're going to be casting, how you want them to land, how far away from you they need to land. Does it need to be a huge fly? Do you need to slap it down to call in every aggressive fish from a mile away? Or does it need to be a really tiny fly with feather light presentation to not spook wary trout? Those are really the questions to start with, I would argue, rather than like, what rod am I going to buy? And then what reel am I going to buy to match the rod? So with that said, we'll jump into kind of what makes all the lines different from each other and why we do it that way. So the first example is a pretty easy one, and that's just weather conditions. These two photos were actually taken within like a week of each other. I caught this true trophy box fish down in the Bahamas last year. And it was like a Bahamian day, 90 degrees and pretty sticky. And then a week later, I was back in Idaho and we were fishing for cutthroats on little tiny midge dry flies, which is a great combination. That was a really good month of fishing for February. I feel like I did okay that year. But the gear we used in these two situations is totally different. So on the left, you've got obviously cold conditions. You can see snow all over the bank and snow on the mountains, and we're all bundled up. So in that scenario, we need lines with a braided core, which is much more supple. We need a softer coating so it stays supple even when it's cold and you can get the memory out of it. And those are the right lines for that scenario. The trouble with those lines is if you take them to the Bahamas or you take them out on a day that's 90 or 100 degrees, that soft, supple coating starts to get kind of gummy just as the material properties of the fly line change with temperature. The mechanical properties are affected a lot by temperature. So in those tropical situations, you need a harder coating. We typically put them on a monofilament core because that's a little bit stiffer as well. And it's nice because it maintains that slickness and stiffness in really hot conditions. But of course, if I took the same line over to the South Fork of the Snake in February, I'd end up with a coily mess and it wouldn't perform very well. And this is also a distinction that I think we do a pretty good job in terms of marketing to steer people in the right direction. If you're going to buy a trout line, it's typically made out of cold weather materials. You're unlikely to accidentally buy a tropical line that's appropriate for like a 9'5" weight, I would say. And then vice versa, if you're buying a line for flats fishing, if it's a bonefish line or a tarpon line, we take care of that for the angler. We put the right materials on the line that is intended for that application. So that one's not too much of a mess yet. And it turns into a real mess when we start talking about this. So as everybody knows, you've got rod weights, you've got 5-weight rods, 6-weight, 7-weight, and then you've got line weights. You've got a 5-weight line, a 6-weight line, 7-weight line. And there's a couple ways you can define line weight. And the first is the AFTA standard. And AFTA is the American Fly Fishing Trade Association. And they basically maintain these standards for what a 5-weight line actually is. The way the standard works is you basically take the first 30 feet of your fly line, excluding level tips, which is kind of a weird esoteric detail that doesn't actually make much difference. But anyways, the first 30 feet of your fly line, you weigh it in grains, which is a weird unit that nobody's used to. It's just a unit of weight. Don't let that throw you. And if it weighs 140 grains, that's a 5-weight line. If it weighs 160 grains, that's a 6-weight line. It sounds really straightforward. You got the whole chart here. You can see they progressively just get heavier and heavier and step up in line weights. A couple things to point out about this. I find that people are very, very hesitant to put a 6-weight line on a 5-weight rod or put a 6-weight line on a 7-weight rod. And I understand why. It sounds counterintuitive. You probably don't want to mismatch your rod weight to your line weight. But the thing I would point out is the difference between those line weights. The difference between a 5-weight and a 6-weight line is 20 grains. 20 grains is the weight of a business card, roughly. So it's not like twice as heavy, right? It's not going to make your rod explode if you cast a slightly heavier line with it. It's really, the differences are small. In fact, the differences are so small, you have to have really specialized equipment in the factory to even manufacture a line that's distinguishable between a 4-weight and a 5-weight. You have to drive so much variation out of the process just to get a line to hit that spec that I don't lose too much sleep over those 20 grains. One more example too would be a 9-foot 2x leader weighs about 10 grains. So if I'm fishing a shorter leader, like we were talking about earlier, my line might feel heavier because I have more line in the air to reach my target. Or if I'm fishing a really long leader, the line might feel lighter because I have less line in the air to reach my target. So that's what the AFTA standard is all about. And then the one that everybody pays more attention to, or at least the one that you pay attention to when you buy a line, is the actual manufacturer rating. It says it right on the front of the box. For some reason, this picture is kind of blurry on my screen, but that says WF5F. So that's a 5-weight line. Ideally, that should match the rod that it goes on. So a 5-weight rod should take a 5-weight line. The catch here, so far, there's no problem. We've got an AFTA standard. You know, they say a 5-weight's 140 grains. We've got a manufacturer standard. We tell you that this line is a 5-weight. The catch is that the 5-weights that we sell rarely match up with the actual AFTA standard. So there's this weird disconnect. We tell you to put this on a 5-weight rod in sort of direct opposition to what AFTA says to put on a 5-weight rod. So why do we do that? Well, we'll get to that a little bit later, but I'll just give you some examples of that kind of weirdness where a 6-weight is not always a 6-weight, is not always a 6-weight. So in this example, let's take four different tapers. These are four lines that Rio manufactures, and they're four that I use frequently. And they're actually four lines that I would put on exactly the same rod. You know, if I have a fast action 9-foot 6-weight, I can think of a situation in a given year of trout fishing where I would use all four of these different lines. So the first one is the technical trout. That's just the name of a taper. It weighs exactly 160 grains. Bingo, right on the spec for a 6-weight line. Second is a Rio Grande. And that one's starting to look weird. We got 185 grains in the first 30 feet now. That's a 7-weight. Like that shouldn't be. Next is the Extreme Indicator. That weighs 210 grains in 30 feet. Now we're in an 8-weight range. Like surely that line won't work. And then last but not least, we have an Outbound Short 6-weight, which is 235 grains. That's actually technically a 9-weight fly line that I'm gonna tell you worked great on your 6-weight fly rod. So if I'm going by my magazine article and it says pick a line to match your rod, and I've got these four lines on a peg in front of me, like which one do I pick? Like that's crazy. So hopefully we'll get to a point where we can answer that question. But the other example I wanted to point out is, it's actually a casting game that Simon Gosworth, who's our brand manager, showed me for the first time. It was actually my first week working at Rio. We were at a sales meeting playing this game, and he calls it the flip flop, which is where he takes the spongiest, slowest action 3-weight fly rod he can find, and then he takes a 10-weight tarpon line and puts it on the 3-weight rod. And then he finds the fastest action saltwater 10-weight rod he can, and he puts a 3-weight dry fly line on that rod. And then he hands you both and says, cast them both as far as you possibly can. And you would think it would go horribly, right? Your first instinct is like, oh, it's not gonna work at all. The 10-weight line's gonna break my 3-weight rod, and I'll never be able to throw more than 10 feet with the 10-weight line or the 10-weight rod and the 3-weight line. It's actually just the opposite. And I'm far from the best caster who works for Rio. Simon is the best caster who works for Rio. And you put those things in his hands and it's magical. I mean, he can throw them both 90 feet without even trying. But it's not limited to the best casters in the world either. If anybody who fishes frequently and has been in it for a few years can sort of adjust to those mismatches of weight and figure out in their casting stroke how to make it work. So I bring that example up only to illustrate that you should never, ever be afraid to experiment with different line weights. Like just because a line says 7-weight on it and you've got a 6-weight rod, that doesn't mean they're not going to work with each other. It just means it might, you know, for you, it might work great. For somebody else, they might think it's a little bit too heavy. And this sums it up pretty well, which is that the AFTA standard, I would say, is limited in its application, but no trout angler or any other kind of fly angler should be limited by what the AFTA standard says. So with the spiel on weight over, we can kind of move into tapers. And before we really start talking a lot about tapers, we probably just need to define some terms so everybody knows what we're talking about. This is a pretty typical weight forward line. It's got a head, which is basically the heavy part of the line. It's got a running line, which is the thin, light part of the line. And in the head, you've got a body, which is sort of the thickest section, front taper and rear taper, which are pretty self-explanatory from the picture here. So we're going to use those terms a lot. I felt like we just probably needed a picture to illustrate what we're talking about there. So we'll start with head. Head is a really important thing on a fly line. And really the thing that bears the most discussion is head length. So they vary a ton. You know, we make lines with heads, a weight forward floating line with a head as short as 27 feet. And then we make others that go all the way up to 65 feet. So it's important to understand the situations where you would use a short headline and where you would use a long headline. And really it goes like this. Long heads are better for carrying line, which means you can lengthen your cast and continue to false cast and continue to control your loop with a lot of line out the tip of the rod. And that's because you have enough weight. The head is long enough that you have enough weight off the tip of the rod that weight can be used to direct the rest of the line. They're also nice because you can pick up longer lengths of line and you can mend more line also. You can pick up the line closest to you and flip it, and that line weight will pick up the rest of your line and carry it with it. So these are best for precise casts. And I don't know if this picture is coming through well enough or not, but there's about 500,000 blueing olives kind of like eddied out here, just waiting to get munched. That ought to be happening on the Henry's Fork in like 3 weeks or something. I'm really looking forward to it. But that's a situation where a long head line is important because you need to put your fly in exactly the right lane to get a fish to see your fly and not just eat a natural that's floating by. So those are situations where I'll actually, while I'm casting, rather than shooting a bunch of line into the cast to reach my target, which tends to decrease your accuracy, I want to have exactly the right length of line measured out so I can shoot, or rather than shoot, I can cast a fixed length of line and put the fly down right where it needs to be. So kind of small flies, precise casts, long mends, that's where you want a longer head fly line. And here you have exactly the opposite scenario. This is a picture that the Sage rod designer Peter took in Parker's Island when we were down there. And this is a school of false albacore just ruining the day of all these tiny little bait fish here. And those fish, if you've never fished for false albacore, they swim like stupefyingly fast. They'll come up and slash through a couple of bait fish and then they'll be 100 yards away again. And in those scenarios, you need to get your fly into the right spot just absolutely as quick as possible. And that's really where a short-headed fly line is going to help you succeed. And that's because you can get the entire head out of the rod tip in as little as one false cast. If I'm holding enough line out and throw one false cast back and shoot a little line behind me, now I've got the entire head out and I'm ready to shoot line towards my target. So those short heads, they deliver the fly very quickly, which is perfect. That's exactly what you need in this scenario when the fish are here now and they won't be in, you know, 5 seconds. The trouble is you have less control on those long casts, so I can't be nearly as accurate. I basically load the rod up and bomb it out there and hope it lands in the middle of that mess. If it doesn't, now I have to strip my line all the way back in before I can pick it up and make another cast. So that's important, short head versus long head. The other piece is the weight relative to the length of the head. So this is where it gets a little bit trickier. I gave you a couple examples of six weight lines. One was the outbound short. And I told you that it's 235 grains. That's like a 9 weight by the AFTA weight standard. And the head's only 30 feet long. So it weighs 235 grains and 30 feet, but then it just drops to a running line behind that. A counter example would be like a weight forward six floating Rio Gold, which is only 168 grains at 30 feet. So now we're within those AFTA limits. but the head is really long. The head is 49 feet long on this fly line. And the total head weight, this is kind of the punchline here, the total head weight is actually 240 grains, almost exactly the same as that outbound short. And that's because we basically decided by casting these tapers on a bunch of different rods, a bunch of different six weight rods, that 240 grains is going to load that rod very deeply. And you don't really want it to load any more deeply than that. We figured 240 grains is about as much head weight as you're going to want to cast. The difference is you just get there way faster in this line. It's only 30 feet of line to get that weight. So what this all boils down to is something we call power. And the power of the fly line is the weight divided by the length. So you end up with a weight per foot, like a grains per foot type measurement. And the outbound short, like we said, 235 grains and 30 feet, that comes out to 7.8 grams per foot. The Rio Gold has almost the same weight, but spread over 49 feet. So you end up with 4.9 grains per foot. So the power is much lower. And really what that power tells you, it's much like leaders. The more mass you have close to the fly, the more powerfully the line will turn over. Because I've got so much grain weight crammed into such a short amount on this outbound short, it's going to throw a way bigger fly. It'll carry a big fly with a lot more power than our counterexample, which would be a Rio Gold. So that's a little bit on power. That, of course, does not account for where the weight is in the line. That just says, you know, I've got my 235 grains in the first 30 feet somewhere. Of course, you can make the line cast differently by changing where in those 30 feet that mass comes in and where it's concentrated. So that is the subject of the next few slides. And I'll warn you, the next few slides go into some physics of how fly casting works. If physics isn't your thing, like, feel free to just tune this out. We'll hopefully bring it back to something that's a little bit more practical and bears more relevance to everyday fishing once we get through this part. So there's my disclaimer here for the engineering speak. Basically, the way the taper works and the way it affects your casting all comes down to a pretty simple physical description of a cast. And of course, it's physics, so we make a million simplifying assumptions. And the first one we're going to start with is that you're not shooting any line. Like, the length of line is not getting any longer. And we're going to start from the point here where you've made your forward cast, you've stopped the rod, the rod is completely unloaded, and it's just sitting there static, and now your line is moving. Your entire length of line is moving. So the next step here, you're obviously holding your line or your rod still. So the line connected to the rod can't go anywhere, and that starts to pull it into the bottom leg of the loop. So we call this the bottom leg, and we call this the top leg. I could also call this the stationary leg or the still leg, and this could be the moving leg, right? But the trick to all of this is the line started with a certain amount of kinetic energy up here, and energy has to be conserved. So as this part becomes still, all the kinetic energy is stored in this section, which is now moving. Now, as the cast propagates, even more of that line becomes still, and even less of it is moving. Kinetic energy is proportional to the mass of the fly line. So as the mass decreases in this top leg, your velocity has to increase to keep your kinetic energy the same. So basically, just to reiterate, that kinetic energy, KE, that can't change. So as your mass goes down, your velocity has to go up to keep that value the same. Now, of course, that's not the whole picture. There's also a drag force that goes on here. You've got a moving section of line here. There's a fly attached to it. So the fly is creating some wind drag. The nose of your loop here is actually moving too. So as that goes into the wind, you're creating drag there as well. And the smaller the nose is, the less drag you're going to develop. So your cast is going to go farther. That's just one of the things you can observe empirically really easily. But drag is proportional to velocity squared. So basically, the faster your fly is going, the more drag it experiences. And as it experiences this drag, you'll lose some of that kinetic energy to friction in the air. So really, the punchline of this whole thing is that the taper of the fly line, depending on where your mass is, you might get earlier acceleration, or you might get more acceleration at the beginning, or you might get more acceleration at the end. So by changing the taper, we control how the top leg of the loop accelerates and how your fly accelerates, and consequently when and how much energy you lose to that drag force. So just to illustrate that point, one other way, I'll show you kind of the two extremes. These would be, you know, bad tapers. They wouldn't cast well, but it's a good way to illustrate this point. And in the first one, you've got all your mass at the very tip of the fly line, right? So if you're casting the same length of line, this still section here, it doesn't weigh very much. The top leg of your loop that's moving, that maintains a lot of its mass, so your fly is not going to accelerate as early in the cast. Down here, we've got the opposite scenario. You've got the line really heavy at the back, and you've got the tip relatively light. So basically, as soon as this heavy piece of line comes around the loop and ends up in the still leg of the loop, the top leg of the loop is going to accelerate much more quickly and much more early. So in this case, you're actually going to lose more energy to drag forces just by having the same weight in a different section of the line. So this line is going to turn over more delicately because your cast is going to maintain less energy all the way through turnover, while this line is going to turn over more powerfully. It's going to really chuck your fly over. So that's the argument. You guys made it through all the physics. Just to show you that I'm not BSing you, I can actually show you a video. It's a really cool video that I found on the internet that demonstrates this really well. Actually, before I do that, let me set the stage. So this guy, the video I'm about to show you, this guy, he takes his two-handed rod out in the yard. If you're not familiar with two-handed rods, don't worry about it. It's not relevant to the demonstration, but he's put two fly lines on this thing. And the fly line he chose is a Rio Scandi shooting head, which again, the exact model is not that relevant other than the taper. So one of the lines he's got rigged up this way where it's heavy back here. He tied this loop to the end of the rod. So you've got all your weight right off the rod tip and it's really fine and delicate here at the end. Then he took the exact same line, another one, and he turned it around and he tied the thin end to the tip of the same rod. So now he's got one rod, two lines on it that are identical, except that one's got the heavy end on the rod and the other's got the light end on the rod. So, you know, functionally it's the same as the example I just showed you here, where it's the, you know, the same line, one's heavy at the tip, one's heavy at the back. Okay, so with that said, here's the video. Let me get to the right point. So we'll start with my assumption. You know, he's making his forward cast. You can see here his rod is loaded up. It's going to unload quickly. Actually, let me make this full screen so you guys can see better.
Yeah, make it a little bigger. That's cool.
Okay. So there you go. That's where we started this whole discussion, right? Was the very end of the forward cast. The rod's totally unloaded and now both lines are just flying. Chris, let's take a look at how the...
Hey, yeah. Chris, so are these lines like tied to the tip of the rod or something?
Yes. Yep. He just tied them off to the tip of the rod. So he's not going to shoot any line at all. He's just going to make that cast. And the idea is just to watch how those loops propagate.
Hmm.
Okay, here he goes. You can see one's pulling ahead of the other already. There you go. Same line, same cast. One reached the end of the cast much earlier than the other. So just for kicks, we'll watch it one more time and I'll stop it in the middle of this time. There you go. There's a great illustration of this point. So this line that's pulling ahead, that one's got the heavy end tied to the tip of the rod. So the heavy end of the line has basically moved into the stationary portion of the loop, which causes the top end of the loop to accelerate much more quickly. And that's what's making that line pull out ahead. The one that's lagging behind is just the opposite. It's still got the heavy part in the traveling portion of the loop. So it's maintaining its kinetic energy. Basically, it's got more mass in the top. So kinetic energy doesn't, you don't have to accelerate to get the same kinetic energy. Okay, I think I said that right. And there you go, that one, the one that's light at the front end has already finished the cast. So that's the demo. I like thinking about it this way just because I think it tells you directionally, as you change things in the taper of your fly line, it tells you what the effect is going to be on the cast. It tells you something about the power that the fly is going to turn over with. It tells you something about the speed that your loop is going to open with. And I find that really useful. And I think that guy's demo demonstrates it perfectly. So if none of that made sense to you, don't worry about it. I'm gonna put it into English in the next few slides here. It's the exact same principle as leaders, which is more mass close to the fly turns over with more power. So what that means for fly line tapers is if you have a short front taper, now more of your mass is closer to the fly. It's gonna accelerate later. It's gonna turn over more powerfully. Conversely, if you have a really long front taper, now it's a longer distance between your fly and the majority of the mass of this fly line. It's going to accelerate earlier. It's going to turn over small flies more delicately, and you'll be able to cast with a little bit more precision with a small fly. We can also play some games with compound tapers, which is something we do a lot of at Rio. Our manufacturing equipment allows us to make really, really detailed specifications for how lines taper, where diameters increase and where they decrease. So we do have a lot of lines that have this feature, but basically if you have a rear loaded compound taper, that just means most of your mass is at the back of the head of this line. So it still turns over very delicately because this gets pulled into the bottom leg of the loop early. The top accelerates. You can have very, very delicate turnover, but still load the rod very deeply. And this makes a really efficient line for roll casting and spay casting. On the other hand, a front-loaded compound taper puts all of that mass really close to the fly. So these ones are perfect for carrying a huge fly, really turning over with a big kick at the end. And most of the lines, if you're trying to maximize the size fly you're throwing, this is a feature you'll find in those lines. Last but not least is rear taper. And this has less to do with the power on turnover and more to do with being able to carry more line and mend more efficiently. So if you have a short rear taper and you cast your line so that, you know, your rod tip is right here and all of this is outside of it, if I wanted to mend this line, now I'm using this running line here to try to influence where the thick part is going. And that's not going to be an easy thing to do. A long rear taper does just the opposite. A long rear taper extends back, so I've got more control over what that head is doing once it's out of the rod tip. So those are kind of three illustrative examples of the features we design into fly line tapers and how they affect the way they fish. So that was a mouthful, but hopefully I can draw it all back together with this example of the six-way lines that all weigh different amounts that we talked about in the beginning. So here you got your grain weights again. You can see every one of them steps up by roughly one aft to standard line size. But again, they're all for a six-weight rod. So now that we know a little bit about taper, we can start to recognize some of the features that I just went over in each of these lines. So the technical trout that's very light, got a very, very long head, which means you can probably carry a lot of this line. It's also got a relatively long front taper, which means it turns over delicately, and a long back taper, which means I can control it at distance. So as the name would suggest, it's for sort of technical trout fishing. This is my favorite line for throwing a dry fly. The Rio Grande, which is one aft to size heavy, you can see the head length shortens drastically from the technical trout down to the Rio Grande. And I don't have the numbers in front of me, but if I had to guess, this 52 foot head probably weighs similar to this 38 foot head. So if all you're casting is the head of the fly line, it's going to load your rod very similarly between the two of them. You can see my front taper got a little bit shorter. My back taper got a little bit shorter. While this is a specialty tool for dry fly fishing and small flies, this is sort of your all around tool that'll get it done with a variety of different flies and setups. Next is the extreme indicator, which is one size heavier again, 210 grains. The head got shorter again. So again, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but I suspect that this 33 foot head weighs very similar to this 38 foot head, which is similar to this 52 foot head. And the feature of this taper that you notice is it's got a really short front taper, only 3 feet. And then most of the weight of the body is just behind that front taper, which means this one's going to be more powerful. It's going to turn over a big indicator rig. So you might have a big thingamabobber and a couple of heavy nymphs underneath it. Because of the added weight and the weight concentrated at the front of this line, it'll handle that rig more efficiently than other lines on this slide here. And last but not least, the outbound short. This is the one that's a full 3 line sizes heavy. It's got the shortest head of all. You can see it's also got a compound taper so that it's heaviest in the first 12, 13 feet. And this is actually the line I use when I go false albacore fishing. It's a great taper for that because you can get that heavy head out of the rod and moving so quickly and shoot line to deliver a fly to your target before the fish go down again. So there you go. There's 4 6-weight lines. They weigh completely different things. They're made for totally different applications. Only one of them meets the AFTA spec, but they're all tools that I would use in a typical year of fishing. All right, the last little point I want to make is I want to go into the example of overlining again. So people tell you, I've talked to fishermen who say like, oh, I always overline my rods. And yeah, I'm not saying that doesn't work. It's not a bad idea to overline your rods, but you have to do it, I think, with a consideration for how much the line you're using weighs. So if I had an outbound short, which is already 3 AFTA sizes heavy, I probably wouldn't want to overline with that. I wouldn't want to put a 7-weight outbound short on a 6-weight fly rod because it's already got that extra weight designed into it. So unfortunately, what this really comes down to is it's extra complication, but fly fishermen, I think, like complication in some instances. Really what you need to know is not only the manufacturer's line rating, but if you're gonna do something like overline or underline, you also would like to know what the grain weight of that line is as well. And the good news is we publish those numbers. So if you're ever curious about this, or you want to know, you've bought a Rio line, or really probably any manufacturer has got this on their website now. For example, if I've got a 5-weight Rio Gold and I want to know what that thing weighs at 30 feet, I just find the line I've got, weight forward 5-float gold. That's 146 grains at 30 feet. So now I can confidently say something about whether that line will work overlined or whether it'll be too heavy or too light. So the example I'll leave you with for overlining is, you know, we're the manufacturer. So we would like you to just have a different line for every application. Like if you're going indicator nymphing, I'd love it if you went out and bought an extreme indicator line, or if you're going false albacore fishing, please, by all means, go buy an outbound short. If you're going to fish dry flies one day and streamers the next, get a technical trout and get a big nasty. That's obviously not practical. Like you can't have every fly line. And I'm really fortunate. I have access to a bunch of fly lines. I fish these things. I design them. I've got prototypes sitting around that I can put on a reel and try something different. And what I'll tell you is even I don't have the right line for every application every time I do it. You know, every time I tie on an indicator rig, it's not on an extreme indicator line. And sometimes I get a wild hair. I still carp fish. I skip trout fishing for a day or two every summer to go chase carp. And, you know, I don't have the perfect carp line spooled up. But I just try to make sort of an educated guess on what kind of line is going to be good for that application. And if I can overline a rod to closely approximate a specialty line, I will. I'm not afraid to experiment with that. So the situation I'll give you is, let's assume I've got my 5-weight dry fly outfit is just totally dialed in. It's a 5-weight X and a 5-weight technical trout, which is like pretty typical of what I fish. But now it's winter. It's, you know, March 1st. There's not a ton of big gnarly green drakes pouring off the river, so I'm probably not going to be doing some really intense dry fly fishing. I'd rather just go fish indicators and nymphs because I want to bend the rod in the middle of the winter. So one option is I could go out and buy myself an extreme indicator, a 5-weight extreme indicator line, which weighs 185 grains. And that's sort of the purpose-built tool for that job. But the other option that I'd encourage you to think about is see if you've got a general purpose line for a different rod that'll approximate that line, right? So an example would be, what I'd really like is a 5-weight extreme indicator at 185 grains. But if I've got a 6-weight Rio Grande at 185 grains just laying around, why wouldn't I put that on my 5-weight and go fish it, see how it works? Similarly, if I've got a 7-weight Rio Gold on a different reel at 193 grains, now we're pretty close too. So you can play this game kind of to no end. If you've got a bunch of fly lines for different rods, and you're willing to mix and match to meet the needs of different applications, you can really extend your arsenal, is I guess what I would say. Last but not least, I just told you how you can avoid buying specialty lines. So now I got to plug a couple of my favorite specialty lines. The first one is the Rio Creek line. These are two that I just think are so cool and they're so unique to Rio. And they're really good examples of why you design lines for specialty applications. So the first one is the Rio Creek. And as you can see, I don't have the numbers up here. It's a really short head. It's a 30-foot head. And it's really heavy at the tip of that head also. And really, this line is designed for super small water. I think we make it 0 through 5 weight, so it does not come in a heavy line size. But the thing I love about it is you can take your little 2 or 3 weight fly rod out with this line. And because it's got so much power at the tip, you can turn over a big fly like you might use on a small creek. You might throw a size 6 stimulator because you're fishing for brook trout and you might as well fish a fly you can see. But what's nice is you can fish basically as light a rod as you want and still have the right weight in that line to turn over a pretty big bushy fly. Like, it might be no trouble for a 5-weight line to turn over a stimulator, but if you've got a 0-weight line, now you might have to work a little harder to get that thing to turn over. So this line, I think, is really cool because it bridges that gap. It allows you to throw a big fluffy fly on basically as small a rod as you want. The other line I really, really like is the single-handed spey. And I know you guys a couple months ago had a presentation about trout spey and how you get into it. And it's a little intimidating. You know, you got to talk about a whole different set of grain weights. There's a bunch of funny names of shooting heads that come from various regions, Skagit head, Scandi head. You got to talk about tips, you know, there's mo tips and versa leaders and poly leaders. It's basically just, it gets really complicated really fast when you're new to spey. And this line I absolutely love because it takes all the guesswork out of that. If I've got a 5-weight single hand rod, a 9-foot 5-weight, and I buy a 5-weight single handed spey line, I can do every single one of those spey casts and really kind of get my feet under me and understand how the mechanics of the casting work without buying any new equipment other than a line. I don't have to buy a rod. I don't have to buy a reel to put the rod on. I don't have to, or a rod to put the reel to put on the rod, or a shooting line, or tips, anything like that. This is just a floating line that's set up to be a really nice spey casting line on a single-handed rod. So I fish this line a lot, actually, in the spring in particular, when hatches are relatively short. You know, if you're gonna get a good hatch, it'll be an hour or 2 hours in the afternoon, maybe. So what I'll do is I'll take this line to the river and I'll swing soft tackles with it. I'll do spey casts with my single hand rod, swing soft tackles, catch some fish that way while I'm waiting for the hatch to come off. And then when the bugs do hatch, I'll maybe adjust my leader a little bit and tie on a dry fly. And with the same floating line, now I can make delicate presentations and fish dry flies really easily. So yeah, those are my two favorite specialty lines for trout fishing. Okay, and the last thing I'll leave you with is that was a lot of technical mumbo jumbo in that presentation. And if you're still just confused and you're having a hard time choosing a line for an application or choosing a general purpose line to cover a range of applications, there's a few things you can do to make that decision easier where you really can't miss. And the first one is ask a fly shop. People who work in fly shops don't do it to pay the rent. They do it because they love fly fishing and they're probably pretty good at it for the most part. They're probably willing to tell you what works for them. And it's a great place to get good advice. If your fly shop isn't local, they would be ecstatic, I'm sure, to get a phone call from you asking about fly lines, particularly if you spend some money with them. The other one, and I kind of emphasized this already, is there's no way you can hurt yourself by experimenting. So there's no holy grail out there. You can't buy a line that's going to just make you a better caster. You can buy a line that's better suited to an application maybe. But really the way you become a better caster is by casting a variety of lines and trying a variety of techniques. So I would encourage you to do just that. Maybe you can go to a local fly shop and cast a variety of lines on a given rod. Or maybe you can cast your buddy's line, or if you fish with a guide, cast your guide's gear. I think that's really important just to understand the mechanics of how a line works with a rod. I don't think you can ever get hurt by casting a wide variety of stuff. And then last, this really is like the last ditch effort. Rio does have a line selector app, and you can kind of plug in specifications for your rod and what you intend to do with it. And it'll make a recommendation. It's based on basically our marketing. It takes into account some of the design intent behind our fly lines and gives you a recommendation for a fly line. That's kind of an impersonal way to get an answer. It does work, but it's limited in other ways, I would say. Like, we don't know the intimate details of every fly rod ever made, so we're not going to be able to give you exactly the right suggestion for an obscure model fly rod. And that's pretty much all I've got. So if you've got any questions, I would be happy to try to answer them.
Cool. So we have questions. I've got a hand up here. Go ahead and unmute yourself, Jay, and ask a question, buddy.
Yes, a number of years ago, a friend of mine received a luminescent fly line. You'd take it and flash it like with a camera, and then at twilight, you go out. That was the greatest training aid ever because you could see how your loop was forming. And I wonder if something like that is still available.
It is. I'm actually glad you asked that question. So we've actually got it in a Rio Gold. I even have the webpage up. How do you like that? So on the Rio website, we have a line called the Lumilux Gold. It comes in two sizes, a 5-weight and a 6-weight. But that's the same thing you're talking about. And I agree, those are really fun to cast at night.
Do we have other questions?
Is that Dave raising his hand there?
Yeah, Dave Rothrock.
Here's my question. Actually, I've got two questions. First, there are some folks that now are offering tippet material in half X's. Is it really possible to maintain that kind of consistency throughout the extrusion process that you can actually control up to, well, basically 5/10?
Yeah, that's a great question. And we actually just recently started offering tippet in half X sizes. And you know, you bring up a good point. There's manufacturing variation. what I can tell you is our half X size tippet is actually extruded through a different size die. So of course there's some variation. If we're talking about the difference between 6.5X and 6X tippet, I can't in good conscience tell you that the thickest 6.5 is not going to overlap with the thinnest 6. But what I would tell you is the center of those two distributions is distinct, and they're measurably different. Statistically speaking, if I measured a bunch of spools of tippet, there would be a difference between those two specs. I can't speak for other competitors. I'd love to throw them under the bus, but I won't do that either.
Yeah, because I just wrote an article fairly recently for an online journal about this new and improved tippet material. And when I mic it out, it comes out up to 2,000ths larger than what it's labeled. And that's a real misrepresentation to the consumer.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, that happens. Of course that happens. What I can tell you is Rio never does that intentionally. Of course there's manufacturing variation, but we try to set our tippet spec at the center of the distribution that comes from the manufacturer. We do measure competitors' tippet too. And of course, without naming names, I've measured competitors' tippet that does the same thing. I think I know who exactly who you're talking about, in fact.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Now, the other real quick question is, when you talk about, okay, if you don't have a specialty line for that particular application, but if you have these other lines, they would serve adequately. Obviously, when you compare a Rio Gold in 7-weight to a Rio Gold in 5-weight, or let's say a Rio Gold in 7-weight to an extreme indicator in 6-weight, there's that weight distribution difference. You're saying that we could find an adequate performance within that range, even with that longer taper, that difference in weight distribution. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah, and you bring up a good point, which is that it'll cast differently. It won't perform exactly the same because the taper for the extreme indicator was designed very specifically with that application in mind. I chose the Rio Gold and the Rio Grande in that situation just because they are sort of generic tapers. They're supposed to be a general purpose line. So I probably wouldn't recommend, if you wanted to approximate an extreme indicator in a 5-weight, I probably wouldn't recommend you go get like a Scandi head that weighs the right amount in 30 feet, because that's going to be a totally different performing line. So there is some mismatch there, and you can kind of try to minimize that. It's probably worth showing you that we publish all the taper diagrams of these things too. So any fly line on the Rio website will have a taper diagram like this associated with it. And that's actually a really helpful tool. We don't really hide much in those. There's nothing proprietary about a fly line taper once you've sold it to a guy. Anybody can mic those things out and copy them pretty easily and do. So yeah, you can look those tapers up and try to get a little bit closer that way.
Hey Chris, I got a question here from Facebook from Bruce. And he said I'm gonna kind of play with his question a little bit before I ask it. It says, assuming an industry-wide standard is useful to consumer, what would a new standard look like? But you know, Chris, you and I have had hours and hours of discussions on this whole business. I think it's helpful to share that before the AFTA standard was established, there was this system that wasn't followed. The manufacturers weren't following different standards. So you couldn't figure out how to use a Cortland line with a whatever other kind of line. And so it was really ambiguous. So the AFTA standard put some guardrail on the process, if you will. And it helped us to, but it's, I think what your talk is saying, and maybe it should be obvious, is if I'm engineering a 100-foot line, if you just tell me 30 feet, you'll only you've only told me part of the story. I want to know more about what you did to the whole 100 feet.
Yep.
Because that is the technology that's going to deliver my fly. And as you pointed out, if I want to put a real delicate presentation down, I don't want to spook fish. I want to back my weight away from the tip. And if I want to really throw a rug, I want to push it towards the tip. It's kind of intuitive, yes. But the point is that if you just told me 30 feet of a 100-foot line, it just is not enough to be fully descriptive. So, and so Bruce is asking a question you and I actually wrestled with, is what language would you choose if you wanted to expand that description?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. So one of the things I was kind of hinting at in the presentation is between a 6-weight gold and a 6-weight outbound short, I've got these vastly different 30-foot weights, right? And vastly different head lengths. But if you look closely, the heads weigh the same between the two lines. And you and I have discussed this question before, Kirk, and we've discussed it internally at Farbank too. And somebody asked me, like, how would you write the standard if you were going to rewrite the standard? And I thought that was the holy grail. I was like, I was really excited. I was like, this is great. We can just say what the head weight is, not like the 30-foot weight. And then I started looking at some of my other favorite lines, and they immediately started violating that rule too. So it didn't work out, unfortunately. I'd love to tell you that that's the answer. Just give me a head weight as an AFTA standard instead of a 30-foot weight, but it's not even that simple. You know, I've put some thought into this. I don't have a better system, unfortunately. I think we're using a system that doesn't work in every situation, but it's also a system that, you know, it tells part of the story, and it, you like it or not, it gives you a benchmark. You know, we talk all the time internally in the group about, okay, are we going to make, what kind of weight bump are we going to put in this line? Is it going to be one size heavier, 1.5 sizes heavier, 2 sizes heavy? It's entered like the vernacular of how we design lines even. So in some ways it's serving its purpose that way. It's a standard that we can talk about and compare and contrast different designs based on. But yeah, you're absolutely right. If you're designing a 60-foot head, giving me a 30-foot weight is not very useful, or not, doesn't give you the whole picture anyway. And one other thing I'll say on industry standards is there's all this talk about line weight standards and how do you improve on the existing AFTA standard. And, you know, why do you, some people just get mad that we violate them. They just, they're angry that their 5-weight line doesn't weigh what a 5-weight AFTA line should. And it's like, well, do you want me to have to sell you a 7-weight line to do what you're doing on your 5-weight rod, or should we design it to, for the application? So there's all this consternation. One thing that very seldom gets mentioned is there is no standard whatsoever for fly rods. Like, what's a 5-weight rod? If you give me, I'll use my own company as an example. So Farbank owns several fly fishing brands. They own Rio, Reddington, and Sage. And so without any bad blood with other brands, I'll use Farbank products only. If you were to hand me a 5-weight Reddington butter stick, which is like the slowest, noodliest graphite or fiberglass rod on the market, and then you handed me a 5-weight Sage Igniter, which is like the fastest, most tuned up, ultra high performance graphite rod on the market, and told me those are both 5-weights, I would like laugh at you. I know they are, but they behave completely differently. So I think it's kind of the same story, you know, calling something a 5-weight rod, that isn't even tied to a standard, and you see the same amount of variation. The difference between a 5-weight butter stick and a 5-weight igniter is probably comparable to the difference between a 5-weight technical trout right at the AFTA standard and a 5-weight outbound short, 3 sizes heavy.
But I think that maybe it would be helpful to have another, you know, if you got a 30-foot and maybe a 60-foot length, it helps be more descriptive, but it won't be fully descriptive. And like you and I have talked, is I actually think the purpose of your talk, because it can sound confusing to a beginner. with all these, why do you engineer all these different tapers? Well, the reason that you engineer those tapers and the reason we want to spend another $80 for an engineered piece of equipment is it helps me to do a job. And so what we can appreciate as fly fishers is thinking about what is it that we're trying to do with the fly line. And I can tell you that I love the outbound short on my drift boat for smallmouth. I never false cast.
Yeah.
I never false cast. And it just drives me nuts. People come in and they're doing 5 or 6 false casts before they put that fly down. We've just gone down 100 feet of bank, prime bank, and they've missed the chance for those fish.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And so the outbound short, that putting a punch on the end, I can deliver the fly quickly, but it's a smallmouth condition, and those fish don't care that you just dropped a log in the water, you know. And so we get to think about what this technology is doing to advantage our fishing. And if there's any good that came out of your talk, I think that's it.
Yep.
Other questions?
Yeah, this is Ken. I've got a question for Chris there. Staying with your chart about the 6-weight reel gold versus the outbound short, my question is, once you've delivered the fly, does the extra mass of an outbound short have a measurably greater sink rate? And is it really worth worrying about, or is it worth even choosing an outbound short because it has a faster sink rate versus a real gold, for instance?
Yeah, that's a good question. And it's something I didn't touch on at all, which is coating density. So I've noticed that people sometimes confuse coating weight with coating density. And you'll hear it frequently when people are talking about sink tips. They'll say like, oh, I fish a 200 grain sink tip to fish this deep, and I fish a 300 grain sink tip to fish this deep. And if I really need to get down there, I'll go to 400 grains. And there's some imprecision of language in that discussion, where the grain weight only refers to how much that section of line weighs. And we can achieve that grain weight with a buoyant coating. So to use your example, a 6-weight gold and a 6-weight outbound short, we make both of those lines in a full floating version. In fact, we don't make a sink tip outbound short, but that's beside the point. But they both float, even though those grain weights are so different because of the density of that coating. Then we've got some lines that have multiple densities. You can buy the outbound short is actually a really good example in that case, where it comes in a full floating version, it comes in a full intermediate version, it comes in a version with a type 3 sink tip, and we do one with a type 6 sink tip. And what that means is, for the same weight spec, each of those 6-weight lines is going to weigh exactly the same amount in 30 feet, but we put a different density coating on each of those models. And what you get, because the line is the same mass but much thinner, there's less buoyant force acting on it, and the denser coating will actually sink much more quickly. Now, I think the question you're asking is for the same density coating. Like if I've got a type 6 coating, let's call the density, you know, 3 grams per cubic centimeter, something like that. If I've got that same coating on a 150 grain line versus a 200 grain line versus a 300 grain line, are you going to see a difference in sink rate? And the answer is you can measure a very small difference in sink rate. You know, one might sink at 5.8 inches per second. And if you add 50 grains to it, it might sink at 6 inches per second. Another 100 grains might get you up to like 6.2 inches per second. I'm kind of just pulling these numbers out of thin air, but they're pretty similar to what we've measured in the past. So there is a bit of a difference there. And it has to do with the effect of the core. So the core is obviously a different density than the coating. And as you put more and more high density coating over that core, basically the composite density of the entire line between core and coating together starts to get larger and larger and approaches the density of that the coating itself.
Well, I've been fishing an outbound short for smallmouth in Lake Erie tributaries for quite some time. Really like the line, and I believe mine's an intermediate. And my thought process of choosing this line was that because there's a lot of rocks and boulders and a lot of those tributaries, is that it's not the speed of the cast as it is that I can kind of dip, get my fly. If my leader's not too long, all right, I can also dip my fly basically behind those rocks where the smallies are waiting. And I've had a fair amount of success thinking that, but I'm not sure technically whether that is really a sound basis.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. So there's people who make the same argument with two-handed rods for a shorter head on a two-handed rod rather than a longer head. And the thought is if you're casting across a bunch of broken currents and you have a short head, you can basically hold your shooting line or your running line out of the water so that your head is being acted on by a smaller width of river, if that makes any sense. So I think I see where you're going with that, and it makes sense to me.
Well, I think of it as the mass also of the head. Does it actually add to that that ability to get behind that rock?
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, I've certainly heard that theory before too. I'm not sure if I have got a good definitive answer for you, but just having more weight, regardless of density, means that any upwellings in the current are going to act less on your line. I don't know if I got a firm yes or no on that one.
Okay, thanks. Appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
Yep, go ahead, Dave.
Yeah, with regard to when you talk about all of these varieties of lines that we have, because of the fact that I teach or casting, fly fishing, guide and all this, I would say as high as more than 95% of the anglers have no concept of the benefits of these differences in lines with regard to the application. And it's really interesting. I've asked folks already, I have a couple of friends who do YouTube videos, and I said, okay, you want a 5-weight line. When you go into a shop, what do you want? And they tell me, I want a 5-weight weight forward line. I asked them, okay, when the shop employee hands you a line, what'd you get? They can't answer me because they don't recognize the fact that there is all of this variation, and it all has to do with how that fly line is going to perform. The other thing is too, a lot of times, I would say most times, when you go into a fly shop, you don't have people that are real knowledgeable about this stuff that are on the other side of the counter. And so if you go in with no clue of what you really want, because you're looking for the best performance conditions you fish most, that's a problem as well. It's like when people ask me, well, what should I do about buying a new fly rod? I always tell them, you take your own fly line, because that's the fly line that you're used to fishing. Hopefully you know what that fly line is going to do in the circumstances that are in the conditions in which you're going to use it. And then you're going to be able to compare apples to apples. Comes to fly lines, most people have no idea.
Yeah, I would agree with that for the most part, for sure. It's in some ways, it's the simplest piece of equipment, you know, buy a 5-weight for a 5-weight. And in other ways, all the ways I just discussed, it can be infinitely complicated. You can you can work full time thinking about it like I do. But yeah, there's better shops and worse shops. The very best shops will know exactly what line to give you for your fishery. And the ones that leap to mind for me are destination shops. Like if you're going to go fish the Missouri River in Craig, Montana, and you walk into Headhunters and ask them, like, what fly line should I buy for dry fly fishing? They're going to have three options for you right away that are all great. And then there's a scale, you know, it's goes down from there. If you go to Sportsman's Warehouse and like find the guy from the archery section and ask him about fly lines, he's not going to have a clue probably. Which this is getting off on a tangent now, but I think that's why fly shops are important. You know, there's a big question now about, do you sell fly lines directly to consumers? Do you sell them through Amazon? Do you sell them to specialty dealers? And you know, there's financial reasons to do each of those, but I would prefer that people buy fly lines. Basically, I want people to get the best fly line for their application, and I want them to be the happiest with the product. And if the best way to do that is to have somebody who really knows their stuff make recommendations at a specialty shop, that would be my preference for how people buy their lines. If you know exactly what you want and you prefer the convenience of shopping online, like, more power to you. But that's my take on it.
I would agree with that, but that's where I believe that the line selection application in your website, for example, is at least as valuable as someone standing or sitting in a fly shop. And it would not surprise me that if we were to conduct a survey, we would find that the vast majority of those fly shop employees utilize that very tool, because that's the way they can get their hands on that information that's going to provide the best information to the customer and allow them to get the best possible product right then and there.
Well, yeah, I'm glad to hear that that's a valuable tool and that you know, people use it that way. That's exactly what it's intended for, is basically our recommendations. You know, we design the lines. There's a lot of intent that goes into that. But there's personal preference too, I guess, is really the limitation. Is the line I like for dry fly fishing and the setup I like for dry fly fishing might not be the same as a shop employee, but there's no accounting for taste, as they say.
So Chris, there's some Facebook comment dialogue, which is along the lines of suggesting different ways to describe fly line behavior, and I think the bottom line is largely this conversation that we've been having, is we really lack the language to describe this in ways that even experts, but for sure folks that are newer to the sport can understand how to leverage the technology. And I think that's a fair assessment of the state of, but I would also encourage that. I think there's a tremendous amount of engineering that's available in the fly line design for fly fishers to leverage. But what we're lacking the language in explaining it simply. What I really loved the graphics that you showed and the video that you showed are really, really helpful, especially to the newer folks, but really, really helpful. And maybe in the future, that's a place to help educate. Because I think we're all kind of wrestling with how do we describe what we're talking about? You know, Dave Rothrock has fished with a 3-weight line on a 5-weight rod forever, and it is amazingly stokey, stealthy, man. And that, you know, the casts just go out there beautiful, but, you know, talk about ultra stealth. And you look at that and you go, well, okay. What's he doing? What physics is he doing? Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's like anything else in fly fishing, where you can go as deep or as shallow as you want, right? For a beginning trout angler who's got a 9-foot 5-weight rod, knowing nothing at all about the applications they're going to be using that rod for, if they don't want to, you know, worry about all the stuff we've been batting back and forth for a couple hours, then I would say 5-weight gold. just by a general purpose line. Up the gut, it's going to work for 90% of your applications. Are there better lines to work for every one of those applications? Absolutely, but it takes a level of desire to worry about that stuff. And are you going to catch hundreds more fish because you've got a line that's perfectly suited to the application? No, probably not, but it might improve your experience. It might be more fun to fish. You might be less frustrated by the result. So, you know, I think there's, you know, making the market as broad as we possibly can and selling lines to as broad an audience as we can, I think is important, in addition to explaining all the details in a cogent way.
Hey, it's Ken again. I'd like to add one other kind of component that wasn't been touched on of sorts. I'm in Georgia, and I fish for stripers quite often down here. And it's depth and speed, all right? So when we're out on Lake Lanier, it's extremely important as to which fly line to choose. We use predominantly, I personally use a Rio intermediate, and most people utilize intermediates, but that's kind of the generic, but it'll catch you the most fish over a course of a year. However, there are times when you need a slower sinking or kind of intermediate sinking line, or even a full sink line, depending upon the depth of the bait and the fish are chasing the bait. So that's whether it's trout fishing, which we do a lot of here in Georgia as well, just like in New York. I'm from upstate New York. And if you're not thinking depth and speed for your presentations and backing that into your fly line choices, a fly line is far more important than the fly rod itself. So it's just adding that thought process that you really should be also considering depth and speed in these overall choices.
Yeah, absolutely. That reminds me of the application I've seen with the absolute most fly lines utilized to great effect is lake angling in the UK. So I had a really cool opportunity to go to the UK and visit dealers and visit shops and spend a couple of days on the water. And I fished with some guys who are in these managed trout fisheries on impoundments in the UK. So it's a lake, they rent you a boat. Everybody goes out with the same boat. There's a strict set of rules on how many flies you're allowed to fish, and you can't set an anchor. You have to drag a drift sock. But the guy I fished with manages a fly shop on one of these fisheries, and he's like the local expert on how to catch these trout. And they have these competitions too, so it gets like pretty cutthroat who can catch the most trout out of these lakes in a set amount of time. And knowing nothing about this game before I went out there, we jumped on the boat. And he puts this like giant, this like huge utility box. I mean, it's like, it looks like it's where you'd keep like your mechanic set of like sockets and wrenches. He like chunks that thing in the middle of the bottom of the boat. And we like take off and we put out there and we get to the first spot and he throws the drift sock over the side and he like opens this thing. And it had all these like foam inserts in it with cutouts for different reel spools. And this guy had 34 spools for his same reel or same set of reels with a different line of each one. And that's exactly what you're saying. It's sink rate and speed and depth. And this guy is like, you know, he's got an intermediate from four different manufacturers that all sink at like minusculely different rates. And he's got a type three line from three manufacturers. And he's got what they call a midge tip, which is a line that has, it's a floating line with like 2 or 3 feet of intermediate at the tip. He's got one with 3 feet of intermediate. He's got one with 4. He's got one with 5. He's got one with 6 feet of intermediate. And they swear by these things. And these guys get so competitive, they actually will darken the lines so that they're all the same color, so that only they can tell what they're fishing. Like if you're the next boat over and you're not getting them and these guys are getting them, all their lines look indistinguishable. So you can't tell what the secret sink rate is. So again, it's a good illustration. There's no end to how into this you can get. Like you can, I went out there with like 2 fly lines. I only fished one the whole day and I caught plenty of fish. So that on the right day, he probably would have crushed me from the back of the boat using a different line. But that day they just happened to, maybe it was easy or something. Beginner's luck, I don't know. But Yeah, you're right. There's so many variables and so many degrees of freedom, and you know, fishermen are superstitious by nature, I would say. So which one is going to actually make the difference is a matter of opinion, I suppose.
So do we have any other questions? Well, cool. Chris, I'd like to thank you. Would you mind stopping the share, and I'll put everybody on grid view here in a moment. So I'd really like to thank Chris for presenting tonight. Really interesting, thought-provoking, little technical discussion. Yes. Great. Thanks turnout. I just thought I'd share out the turnout. So hi to everybody. It's good to see your faces. That's kind of the thing that stinks about not being able to get together is not being able to see everybody and kind of catch up. But good to see everybody's faces. Stay well. We're going to be, it's going to be spring here in another few weeks, and the ice is off the Ontario trip. So good. We're heading in the right direction. So thanks again to Chris.
Yep. Thanks for having me, everybody.
And thanks.
Great job, Chris.
Thanks.
Very informative, Chris. Thank you.
No problem.
All right. With that, we'll wish you a good evening. Hey, and Baxter's on. Baxter's away from his, he had to step away. Darn. Cool.
He was there.
Information. That was great.
That really was. Great presentation.
Thanks. Happy to do it.
All right. Thanks, buddy.
Yep, no problem. Hi, Mom and Dad.
Hey, Chris. Hi, Chris.
Good to see you, guy.
Hey, thanks for speaking up for my end of the market. Weight Rio Gold, all the way.
That's the one. Yep.
All right. Good night, everybody.